Okay, now I'd like to go back to the drawing of a software under test that I feel like I've drawn about 30 times already, and recall that this provides APIs, and that most of the time that's what we're fuzzing. Now on the other hand, when a software under test uses APIs, like the Unix read call, we could do fuzzing at this level as well, and it's most often called fault injection when we do that. And random fault injection, as we've discussed, is extremely powerful. So we've looked at examples of both of these, and both of them are incredibly useful. So what I'd like to talk about now is fuzzing of the implicit inputs that we talked about in Unit 2, where we have non-API inputs to the software under test that affect its behavior. And it turns out that this is often pretty important. And so how would we do this? Well, as we mentioned earlier, possibly the most important implicit input is the timing at which different threads are run on different processors. So that is to say, the thread scheduler provides a very important form of implicit input to multi-threaded software under test. And so an extremely important technique is perturbing the schedule. And as far as I know, there isn't a single best way to do this. And so what we find in practice is people do a lot of different things. One thing you can do is just generate load on the machine. That is to say, make sure that your testing is not happening on a completely idle machine. It's often the case that if you test software on a completely idle single core machine, even if it has multiple threads, those threads will be scheduled in a quite deterministic way. Similarly, if you have a multi-core machine that has more processors than your application has threads, there's again the strong possibility that they'll be scheduled in an extremely deterministic fashion while you're doing testing. And if they're being scheduled extremely deterministically, that means that the scheduler is exploring only a very tiny fraction of the full set of possible thread schedules, and what that means is concurrency bugs are going to go unfound during testing. So generating load by running apps, generating load by running other applications is important. Generating network activity on the machine can also be valuable. And network activity is interesting because incoming network packets to the machine cause interrupt handlers to fire, they cause lots of kernel routines to run, they cause cache lines to be stolen away from your application, and this causes some perturbation of the schedule. There also exist specialized tools for stress testing of multi-threaded applications. And if you have one of these available to you, it would be an extremely good idea to use it to help test your multi-threaded code. Okay, so what I've just covered is what I'll call external perturbations to the thread schedule. It's also possible for your software to introduce perturbations internally. And one way to do that is to do things like inserting delays before and after acquiring locks, and also around accesses to shared variables. This entails a fairly high cost. This isn't so easy. But on the other hand, it might be useful. And I heard a story one time. It was about a group of researchers who were working on formal methods-based tools for finding bugs in threaded codes. And these researchers were having some sort of a competition where each of them tried to find the most bugs in the software under test that they could. And what happened was somebody showed up and just put a bunch of sleeps inside the application and showed that they could find just as many bugs as these super heavyweight, super complicated formal methods tools. So a final thing you can try is what I'm going to call unfriendly emulators. I'll put that in quotes because I'm kind of just making up that name. But what these are is a kind of special virtual machine or other runtime that's specially designed to stress test your application by doing things like invalidating cache lines, invoking thread schedules in odd ways, and other things. And so there are some of these kind of things generally available. And if one of them fits the needs of whatever your software under test is, you should definitely use it.